Today's podcast is brought to you by WarbyParker.com. Get a free 5-day home try-on at WarbyParkerTrial.com/David Feldman Show. 5 pairs, 5 days, 100% free.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Are we rolling?
Yep.
Oh, hello. Many of you may not recognize this voice. It's David Feldman with his cold going into its fourth week.
It's been held over.
Yes. See that? I've got good news for my listeners. I have the worst laugh, and I can't do anything about it. I've worked on different laughs. I have a hoarsey, loud laugh, and it's just getting worse. The good news today is my cold makes it impossible for me to laugh because I'll start coughing. So the listeners will not hear me laughing. Well, we have a great show. Let me just thank Kevin Bartini for interviewing Richie from The Sopranos. We're going to try to get all The Sopranos on the show. I just watched The Sopranos over and over again. And we had David, how do you pronounce it, Provel?
Provel
on the show. He played Richie.
Richie Aprile.
Yeah. Who, I don't know how many people watch The Sopranos, but that was one of the creepiest performances in the history of television. And I remember Dennis Miller met him at an HBO party. We were doing the show at HBO at the time. And Dennis met David and he goes, listen, I can't talk to you because if you end up being a nice guy, you're going to ruin The Sopranos for me. And he walked away from David Provel, who I didn't get to meet because I've been sick. But the great Kevin Bartini filled in for me. So thank you for that. DavidFeldmanShow.com. Please go to our website. And, you know, if you shop on Amazon via our website, you can help support the show. We get a small percentage of everything you make. It doesn't cost you more. You're actually taking money out of Jeff Bezos' pocket. He has to pay me. And that's saving Main Street in many ways. I'm making that up. You're not saving Main Street.
Good old Main Street Feldman.
Main Street. I speak for the common man. That's what I'm about. Well, one of the books you can buy via the David Feldman Show website, if you click on the Amazon banner, is a book called Everything is Coming Up Profits, The Golden Age of Industrial Musicals, written by my guest Steve Young and his friend. What was his name?
My co-author, Sport Murphy, a marvelously talented and funny man who together we tackled the basically unknown show business universe of musical theater productions created for company sales meetings and conventions.
Right. And if I were feeling better, I'd be giggling already. You've been on the show before.
Thank you.
Yes, and I wish you were here every week. We have a new friend of the show, David Sirus.
Yes, hello.
You are a multiple Emmy loser.
Technically one loss. My new job just was recently nominated and lost also.
Yes, you.
I lost the SNL Emmy.
Right, you wrote for SNL for several years. You've written on...
1 year, yeah.
It felt like several years. You wrote for the Comedy Central roasts recently?
Yeah.
You wrote on the Ann Coulter one? And
the Rob Lowe and the Justin
Ann Coulter
Bieber
roast.
Yeah, the roast of Ann Coulter. Yeah. I was very proud.
And Justin... And you are Brick Stone.
Yeah.
You're a YouTube sensation.
A little bit.
We'll talk about that in a little while when we get to politics, because I have not seen Brick Stone, but you go and interview
hate groups, Westboro Baptist Church, the street preachers, sometimes conspiracy people, basically anyone I think deserves to get...
My second wife's family.
Anyone who deserves ridicule in public, so yes.
And okay, that we'll get to in a second. And
you're going to hell.
That's what they tell me.
I think he just arrived. He's on my show. Steve Young, Let me introduce Steve Young to our listeners. He has written for the David Letterman show since 1842.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Prior to the discovery of gold at Sutter's Mill. So that tells you just how mm-hmm. far back we're talking about.
You were there from, I think you were the longest running writer for David Letterman, right?
I did not quite outrank Dave himself, but yes, 1990 to the end in 2015.
Did you beat Gerald Mulligan's record? Gerard Mulligan's record?
Jerry, well, let me think. Well, it gets murky because he worked on the morning show with Dave mm-hmm. in 1980, and then after that, 82 to 2004. So we're pretty similar runs, I guess.
I keep hearing stories about you.
Okay.
Great stories about you. You're also, you've written for The Simpsons, and you've written for Maya and Marty, and you have a new documentary.
Well, I'm not the filmmaker. I'm not producing it, but I am
the subject.
Your charming on-screen character who leads you into the mysterious and surreal world of corporate musicals, and that is the Industrial Musicals movie, and I'm proud to say my old boss, Dave Letterman, is an executive producer on it, and like many documentaries that have a long road to follow, I can't tell you right now when it'll be done or when it'll be out, but it's coming along great.
I saw the sizzle reel.
Mm-hmm.
And you're featured. It's about you to some degree.
I'm the person that you enter this world with and through, and hopefully my enthusiasm and amazement is catching.
And Dave is in it, and they talk about you. And I've heard stories, because I didn't know, I knew of you, but until I got to work with you, I didn't. Harvard Lampoon, I mean, you're the real deal. And I've heard many great stories about you. Two things I'll bring up. One is I was told by several people that they would not start the morning meeting until you showed up, and you always spoke first.
Well, that seems a little bit revisionist to me. I tried to be there on time, and I was usually there within a minute or two of when it was supposed to start. And then I think many days different people spoke first, but I was pretty confident that I was going to show up and open my mouth and have something worth pitching, or at least some amusing self-deprecating comment about why I didn't have something to pitch.
And I've heard from several people that if Steve Young laughed at something you said, that meant a lot. That's what I've been hearing.
Okay. Well, I do have a very severe and advanced case of comedy damage. We probably talked about this before.
Right.
After all these years of thinking of bits and jokes and rewriting them and working with the monologue and just scanning pages of material, desperately looking for the right thing to fill a need, it became more mathematical than joyous in certain realms of comedy. There are certain things that I will still laugh joyously at, especially in the moment in conversation spontaneously with people. Stuff that's produced and written, I now kind of look at with a more calculating eye, and I'm scanning all the schematic diagrams behind it as I listen.
I've also heard from three other writers that you once strangled a man with just your left hand, even though you're a righty.
Yes, but, you know, I'd let my fingernails grow for quite a while, so I had more grip and reach, because you know they curve if you let them go. They kind of spiral, and you can leverage that, yes. Also, the guy was asking for it.
The other classic story, and then I'm going to stop sucking up to Steve Young, is that when the big announcement came down that Dave was leaving, there was this big meeting, and they were breaking it to the right. I'm not violating any confidentiality. This is common knowledge among writers in New York. The news came down. There was a big meeting, and they announced that Dave is not renewing his contract.
He's going to announce his retirement this evening on the show.
And there was sadness and bleakness, and there was the writer's room. And if you were going to say something, it had to be spot on. because this was your, if you blow it, you know, this is, and I'm not going to ruin it. So, because I want to ask you a question about this.
Okay. Well, I had forgotten this story until one of my colleagues reminded me of it within the past few months. But so the head writer gathered us all together in the early afternoon one day in April and said, Dave is going to announce his retirement on this evening's show. And then there was a pause of, I don't know how long it was, 15, 20, 25 seconds. And I said, but Paul's not leaving, is he?
Okay. I can't laugh.
I had completely forgotten about that. I mean, that was just every day in that room. That was the kind of energy and vibe that we always had.
I heard it brought the entire room to a halt. But the idea that Paul would be taking over the show and we'll all have jobs. So there was a 20-second pause, and I was talking to RJ about this 2 days ago.
Yeah, he's the one who reminded me of this.
And we were trying, like RJ said, you had to nail it. Like if it didn't get a laugh, it would have been really. So what was going through your mind? Did you feel pressure or did you just not care?
I think at that point I'd been so comfortable in that room for enough years that I didn't run mental calculations about right. how this will play. I just. One thing I do miss about that room was the sense that I was the most full, confident, unstudied version of myself, and I would just open my mouth and say things that were my sensibility and not worry about it. So,
the best one that I've ever heard. I won't. There was a funeral, and John Lovitz. There was a wake, and John Lovitz was there. I'm not going to mention anybody else's name, but there were a group of actors, comedians, writers. This was about 20 years ago. And it was a very depressing, sad wake. There were kids involved. And somebody got up and said, this is so terrible. The man we love has passed away. His significant other has passed away. His children now don't have an aunt and an uncle and parents. And John Lovitz says in the back, you're making it sound a lot worse than it really is.
the place just
shook because it was obviously a very sad.
Right.
They needed it.
Yeah, where the kids were orphaned by this tragedy.
Well,
and
I like that.
You really have to roll the dice at that kind of.
The best version of that I ever heard, and we may have talked about this at some point, 2 days after the Kennedy assassination in 63, Lenny Bruce goes up on stage, and I don't know where it was, whether it's in New York or wherever it was, and how do you get up on stage as a comedian and even begin to think, how is our way into anything other than tragedy at this moment? And the story is that he stood there for a long minute. And then he said three words, which I don't know if people will understand now, but they were poor Von Meter. Von Meter was a impressionist comedian who had built up a career with a Kennedy impersonation that he had parlayed into an album called The First Family with all the Kennedy clan, and he was doing all these voices, and this was clearly exactly true, because his entire livelihood had just disappeared in a flash of an assassin's bullet, and it was right, and it was the wrong thing, and it was the right wrong thing to mm-hmm. get on that horse with. So I'm always looking for the right wrong thing to say or do or whatever.
There was a time when you couldn't joke about anything, and were you writing for Letterman during the O.J. Simpson trial?
Yeah. Like 95.
So I have this theory that may or may not be true. How old were you, Mr. Sirus?
Oh, at OJ?
Yeah.
I was like 14.
Okay, maybe? So you were watching late night television?
Yeah, I was aware.
Okay. My theory, and it's just an observation, it may not be true, that late night comedians didn't joke about tragedy. If it had a whiff of sadness to it, in the setup, you stayed away from it. And then O.J. hit, and you had the Dancing Itos, and on Leno, is it my imagination, or did Leno break the taboo of telling jokes where the setup was tangentially related to an absolute tragedy?
I do remember there being a great uncertainty about how do we approach this story. And I believe Howard Stern came on to talk to Dave one time as a guest and said, how come you're not doing jokes about the O.J. trial? I mean, this is huge. This is the big reference. And Dave said, I'm not really comfortable doing comedy about a double murder.
Mm-hmm.
And that seemed principled. And yet I don't think we could stay on that stance forever because it was such a huge cultural thing. And after a while, you were one or two degrees of separation removed from the grisly, bloody horror of it. You had this world of a courtroom drama with characters and details and references that, in the same way after 9/11, it took a while to get the Letterman show and any show, I think, in some sort of comedic footing about the new world we found ourselves in. And for a few weeks, we did completely non-topical humor. We did top 10 lists that were akin to the very earliest ones that had ever existed, which were things like words that almost rhyme with peas, things that had no topicality at all. But eventually, we found ways to start talking about Osama bin Laden and taking clips of him and re-editing them or redubbing them or what, some way to just get our teeth into this form of evil needs to be discussed and hopefully through comedy exposed as ridiculous and foolish.
I would assume during World War II, they did Hitler jokes and Mussolini jokes and Charlie Chaplin.
Yeah, and the little dictator or whatever
that
was.
Yeah, and you know, Bob Hope would make fun of Adolf Hitler.
Right, and the Warner Brothers cartoons with the racist Japanese characters and
right.
things like that.
Of course, didn't Chaplin apologize for the Hitler impersonation after the Holocaust became public knowledge? Didn't he even say he wouldn't have done it if he knew about it?
Did he really?
I remember hearing that, yeah, that he did it because this was just a president or prime minister, whatever, that we were against, or dictator.
Chancellor.
Thank you. Yeah, I was like, but yeah, after the Holocaust.
Did you notice I just corrected him and did it in a very supercilious way?
Yeah, well, I think that's just the cold medicine.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, no, he later said he was sorry. Now, who knows if he really wouldn't have done it, or it was just saying sorry, felt like the thing he was supposed to do. But yeah, there was that. I mean, he was still killing millions of people,
mm-hmm.
but how he was doing it, that was the line.
Interesting.
But it's a constant shifting line, case-by-case basis sort of thing. But I was recently reading about Hogan's Heroes. I'm teaching a course at NYU this fall about TV history, and I'm just
wow.
like reading up on things and
wow.
watching things I hadn't seen before. So by the mid-60s, TV executives decided...
I'm sorry, Alex, our producer, just I think he just creamed himself.
Oh, yeah?
He's in heaven now.
At the mention of NYU or Nazis?
Ahead. Nazis.
Okay. So by the mid-60s, apparently TV executives and networks had decided, all right, we've had a good period of 20 or so years to think about this. It's time we hit World War II as a comedy area. So you had McHale's Navy bumbling slackers in the South Pacific.
Right.
And you had Hogan's Heroes... Allied prisoners of war in a German camp with Colonel Klink and what's his name, Schultz.
Mm-hmm.
But what I didn't know about this until recently was all the German characters were played by Jewish actors, very specifically. They apparently felt like this is our due now. We get to do
right.
this.
We get to make them buffoons.
This is the last thumb in the eye to that regime.
And a name prominently displayed, the executive producer of that show, do you remember?
No.
Edward Feldman.
Really?
Yeah. No relation. But the name Feldman, it was like saying, we got a Feldman. Mm-hmm. This has the stamp of approval from a Jew.
So
it's that show holds up. It's shot... The acting is really good, and I'm a sucker for good lighting,
uh-huh.
and it's really well lit. There's an authenticity to it. Or not an authenticity, it's just almost cinematic.
Well, I'm tempted to laugh at your thing about good lighting, but I've seen enough old TV now that doesn't look good that I sympathize with that.
No, but Hogan's Heroes is well lit.
Okay.
And a dry, bad lighting, if a show is poorly lit, I find it really distracting.
So that's why you're doing an audio-only podcast.
And even on an audio-only podcast, the lighting is bad on me, and I look aged. The rule of making fun of Bin Laden on Letterman is a tradition. He's the enemy. I'm talking about the coarsening of American culture, taste. What is stuff that we could joke about 20 years ago and 30 years ago? The line has significantly moved. I remember, well, maybe it hasn't. I don't know.
Well, things have gone in different directions, in different streams. Like, what was that show came on recently, an alternate history present-day thing where the Nazis did win World War II? What was that called?
I don't know the name, but I know they're the reason there were tons of swastikas on the subway.
And then there weren't.
Yeah,
and
people got upset.
Then it was
somehow.
All right, it's going to be an eagle logo. People said, no, it's too upsetting and horrible to, even in this alternate historical universe show, to show swastikas. And yet, I believe Hogan's Heroes, they were marching around with them on their armbands. And I was watching an old Carol Burnett sketch from the 70s in which an Allied prisoner of war is being interrogated by two Nazis, and there's a giant swastika hanging there, and it just, like, that's prop number 7 when you do Nazis. You have to have all these, and now we say this is so virulent and powerful, an emblem of what is unacceptable, that even that reminder of it is unacceptable.
It's always the SS now. Whenever they have Nazis in like a sketch or something, they'll always have the SS logo where the swastika would go. Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting. That's interesting. I think at one time the Jews didn't own the swastika. I think after World War II, most men and women who went off to fight Hitler were not Jewish, and they were entitled. They owned the swastika. They could laugh at it.
Mm-hmm.
But then they use it as leverage for a loan.
Mel Brooks doing Springtime for Hitler.
He was in the Battle of the Bulge.
Mm-hmm.
But he's also Jewish. I'm just saying that as the years go on and more the Greatest Generation dies off, and they were entitled to make fun of the swastika. But now what's left is it's really the Jews and the gypsies and the gays who should be but you know that there were homosexuals in prison 30 years after the Holocaust, that Hitler had locked up homosexuals, sent them to Auschwitz. When they were liberated, the British looked at their crimes and kept them and just transferred them to another prison. They let the Jews and the gypsies go, but the gays stayed in prison up until about 1968,
72.
Really? There were still gay Germans in prison for Nazi-era crimes of sodomy.
That is disgusting. The gypsies should have been there, too.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Kind of interesting. So you were a fat kid.
A little bit, yeah. I'm a naturally chubby person. I have to do a lot of cardio and to maintain my just average American physique.
Yeah. Growing up, did you think of yourself as a fat kid?
Yeah, I wasn't like a big fat. I was, you know, a portly child. But I don't think it was a major factor in why kids didn't like me. I think it was just more what to cling on to when you want to make fun of someone, not the reason.
Did they make fun of you for being heavy?
Not especially. They made fun of me for a lot of other things.
Like what?
Just being weird. Just being weird and...
Now you're an artist, too, besides being a great comedy writer.
Yeah, I used to draw a lot. I mean, I still do. I went to college for illustration. I was always the kid who drew. And actually, that was like the one thing that a girl I knew in like middle school once said, that's the only safe thing you can say about Dave. Mm-hmm. He's a good artist. because it was one of those things where they would tell me, like, you know, it's not personal. It's just that
you're the other.
There are certain people you have to not be nice to. And I used to blame people like that. Now I realized it was just all a jungle and everyone was trying to survive.
And are you stronger because of that? Had you been protected? The myth now is Donald Trump's influence on kids notwithstanding. Our kids now are being protected from being called out for being fat or ugly. Had you been protected, would you have wanted to be protected from being called fat?
You know, being called fat wasn't the real problem.
Watch. I get them to cry.
Well, the truth is, the bullying was never the problem for me.
Were you bullied?
A little bit, but not what, like, people, when they really talk about bullying. I wasn't getting beaten up. I wasn't getting, you know, assaulted. I wasn't afraid to walk home. The being made fun of was not the big problem for me, the thing that people are against. What really was the problem was just not having friends. That was a much bigger deal than kids not liking
it. And was it because you were heavy?
No, it wasn't at all. That was just something that occasionally would be the thing to make fun of. There are popular fat kids. It was just because of what I was like, because in my opinion, I was undiagnosed autistic, you know, mildly. And when you're weird,
but I don't pick that up from you.
I think I've sort of at least adapted to it. I feel it. I feel my, like, where I feel like in general social terms, I feel like I'm always just sort of trying to mimic what a person acts like.
Yeah, I do that.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think a lot of comics.
Yeah, you got a ways to go on that.
Oh, Jesus. All right, hang on. Let me take my hands off my penis. But I always maintain that if you mimic good behavior, eventually you become a good person.
Fake it till you make it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I can see that. I mean, different moods. Like if I say, well, I'm kind of glum feeling today, but you know what? I'm just going to snap a switch over and just walk around and be a little more cheerful and see if that sticks. And I can see that it usually does.
Yeah.
I do think it made me a better person, though. I think being what I thought of as being, you know, not victimized, but, you know, feeling like a victim in certain ways. I do think that, I don't know if it made me stronger. I guess it very well could have. But I do feel like it's the reason I care more about people who have real problems.
Didn't Jerry Seinfeld and Chris Rock say that bullying is good?
Yeah, probably. And, you know, for some people it is like, you know, like steel.
Battle hardens you.
Yeah. And I'm sure all the closeted gay kids who committed suicide because they were being bullied were grateful, because it takes a lot of courage to kill yourself. I don't see how – I'm being sarcastic. I don't see how any bullying works. I just don't.
To make kids better?
Yeah.
I think for some people –
How did it make you better?
I don't know. I'm not saying that bullying is good. I think that it probably overall
did
is
you bully?
Negative. No.
Yeah, you're not a bully, are you?
I didn't, and but who knows? I might have been okay with that if I didn't feel it myself. If I didn't identify with kids who got bullied, maybe I would have been that way.
But if you are bullied, you tend to bully, right? But you don't do that.
I think so. I didn't bully anyone. I certainly did the exact same thing to other kids who were less popular than me when that eventually happened, because for years there was no less popular.
So
than
when
me.
Did you lose your weight and become a guy who?
High school.
What prompted the weight loss?
Once I hit puberty and it was sort of like a possibility that you can work out and – oh, yeah. Well, actually, no. Let me back up. Well, I was beaten up when I was 12, and so I started going to the gym. Mm-hmm. My dad wanted me to go to the gym. He wanted me to go to a boxing gym, and my mom wouldn't let me.
How badly were you beaten up?
Not bad.
How many guys?
Oh, just one kid. One bigger kid. You know.
I am sorry about that, by the way. I think about that often.
But he was heavy.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I was beaten up.
Yeah, it wasn't like a savage beating or anything. You know, it was just more emotionally humiliating, and it made me want to work out more, and, you know, just I was shallow. I wanted to be pretty and I wanted to get girls and I wanted to earn, you know, respect from people somehow. And I think the fact that I didn't have any made me want to work harder at it.
What about if you're just a fat kid? I'm being serious. You're a fat kid who doesn't dress well, and you're 18, and you're a so-so student, shouldn't there be a woman who just loves you for what's inside?
I'm sure there will be.
Or do you have to dress properly and shower and have some kind of success in order to make yourself attractive to another woman? And does that make women shallow?
Well, sorry. Go on, Steve.
Well, it just seems so hard to get past first impressions of people, and you can become wiser and over time think that person has a soul that might be the most beautiful soul in the world, but how will I know? I'm surrounded by 100 million people in all directions, and where do you even start? I mean, you just got to see. I mean, you might have a wonderful random interaction with somebody and think, oh, that person seems interesting, and that can get you past your first impression of how
is a woman being superficial if she comes to my apartment and I'm wearing mom jeans and I've smeared my feces all over the place and there are flies and rats and mice and
no, it's not superficial, but it is superficial
lying around, and I'm saying, but you should love. You should get past all the smell and the ugliness and see what's inside my soul. Isn't she
a beautiful soul? Yeah. Clearly is glowing through all these clouds of flies.
Yeah.
Well, I think that...
I'm being serious. I don't think
it's more men or women that I can tell that are more or less superficial on this. I think that's just a bedrock human thing.
Right. I think guys actually believe, I'm speaking for all men, that they should be loved based on the way they are right now, without shaving, showering, dressing properly, cleaning up the apartment. Don't you think that there's a certain age where guys think that a woman should just love me for who I am, as opposed to this macaroni and cheese that's petrifying on my bed?
Is that an early age that would think that, or is that later in life?
Well,
would think
I have an arrested development. Well,
I think that the question is really that if you want to be a slob, if you want to be out of shape, if you don't have, you don't dress well, you can find love. But you better not be a hypocrite. You better settle for someone who also is in bad shape, who doesn't take care of themselves. There's always someone who's on your level.
What about the phenomenon of very attractive women who are attracted to slobs?
They're just broken inside. They're an exception. I think that
I'm not aware of these people.
Well, it's because women's instincts are just sort of they're much less predictable than men's. Men want a woman who looks like she can give birth to a bunch of your kids, whereas women want, you know, on an instinctual level, women want a man who can protect them, and there's so many ways you can interpret that.
Right.
And I think that's where you end up with where a beautiful woman like in a slob. But the thing that you're saying, the point you're making, is a very good one, because a lot of people are slobs, and they say, well, I want someone to love someone for me. And it's like, no, you want someone pretty to love someone for you. Why don't you just settle for someone who's also a three? And if you think they should settle for you, why shouldn't you settle for them? That's only fair. I think you have every right to be a slob. You just have no right to expect someone to forgive that. There's slobs out there for you, too. You could be happy together.
Yeah, but it seems like you have to say, I want to make the effort to meet someone halfway, and as a mark of respect for myself as well as for whoever I might meet.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're not bothering to do that, then you're going to end up with somebody else who has very little respect for themselves or anyone else. So.
You know, my shrink said to me, why wouldn't women find you attractive? You're working, you know, you know, blah, blah, blah.
Get new glasses, by the way?
No, these are old Warby Parkers. Which
They're marvelous, and I can see that women would find those appealing.
Warby, they're one of our sponsors. These are Warby Parkers. I have not had time to get my contact lenses, so these I do feel, as beautiful as these are, they're a little too horn-rimmy for me, and they make me come across as pedantic.
I think that's a good look for you, though. Pedantic.
I don't like being pedantic.
Who names their kid Warby?
I know. But I said, well, if you're going to judge me on what I do for a living and if I have a somewhat steady whatever, you know, that's not an attractive trait in a man. Shouldn't you be attracted to kindness? And I'm being serious.
Well, people always say that they're so dazzled by the sense of humor, and that I think, and David, you're a stand-up. Do you find that you were saying even as an adolescent, you were trying to figure out a way to be appealing to women, and did it seem like comedy was a way to do that?
It's not why. I think deep down I was being funny just for friends more mm-hmm. than women, because it was before that was even considered a possibility for me. I didn't think I was going to lose my virginity. Like,
how old were you when you lost your virginity?
20.
You beat me. I was 21.
Oh, wow. I was waiting for some reason. I wanted to have it be the right situation, which I realize now was just an excuse I was making for myself. And that I didn't lose it to the right person anyway, so it was a waste of time. But I mean, there's no question being funny helps.
No joke about the sister or the dad or nothing. We just let that one go. Okay.
But I mean, yeah, let's face it. Comics get laid for being funny. And we're mostly funny as a replacement for other things that could have gotten us attention, I feel.
Mm-hmm.
And people become musicians because women like rock stars. And so you can be funny, you can be a rock star, you can be rich, you can be a powerfully built, classically handsome dude. All different ways to approach this. Me, I was lucky. I was born with all these.
Well, we've gone 5 minutes. I think this is a record on any podcast without talking about the orange elephant in the room, Donald Trump. But I think it behooves us now to talk a little bit about Mr. Trump and Michelle Obama's speech last week. Did you see Michelle Obama's speech?
Oh, yeah.
No.
Tell us about Michelle Obama's speech.
It was, and I saw it because Rachel Maddow acted like she was about to reveal that aliens had landed on Earth. I thought that and I like Rachel Maddow.
Rachel Maddow.
I like her a lot. I thought that I was when I found out that's what she was teasing, the speech that we'd already seen, I was like, oh, come on, Rachel. But it was good. She put out more emotion in that speech than I can ever remember her having aside from like the convention. And it was a full on, you're a pig, without saying his name, doing it in as classy a way as possible, talking about women and, you know, growing up and women's rights. And it was just the most perfect trap you could try to set for Trump to pick a fight with her, the person who he has the worst person in America that he could start attacking.
Oh, I didn't even think about that.
I thought of it all the time as...
That's a brilliant observation.
His whole team must have been on their hands and knees begging him not to go back at her about this.
Wow, it never even occurred to me that he would do that. And No.
Pence has been pushing a little bit because he can do it a little more classily, I guess. But no, Trump hasn't really attacked Michelle. I think that's the one.
You know what?
He knows.
I'm on cold medicine. I don't want to overreact, but that is such a brilliant. I didn't even. You're so right. It never occurred to me that it was genius to have Michelle deliver that speech, because you're right. She was saying, okay, come at me. I watched it. I thought, well, here's an African-American woman, mother of two girls, women. There was nothing patronizing about that speech. When you hear, you know, I have a mother, I have a sister, I have a daughter, screw you. It's wrong, you know, don't be, you know.
The human beings, right.
Yes. Yeah. But when it came from Michelle, it was pure. I hope it was pure. You know, I don't think she's that much of a political animal.
I think I think there's no reason to believe she doesn't actually think Donald Trump is as disgusting as she purports. I mean,
and for me, and I'm not ashamed to admit this, this is why the speech is so powerful. Coming from her, I understood the crime that Billy Bush committed. That she didn't mention Billy Bush, but, you know.
It sounds like a joke, but you're right.
I'm being serious.
Yeah, yeah.
In that, you know, I go through the motions of being offended because I know right from wrong. I know, you know, I'm 58, and I've gone through my past and I start thinking, well, what did I do? What did I do? And I go, I never did that. I made really bad taste jokes that were so over the top but I never talked that way.
I mean, there was something.
I think there were a couple of things probably shouldn't have said that could have been taken the wrong way, like keep your mouth shut and you won't get hurt, and the gun. I shouldn't have done that. But other than that, it was the 90s.
It's a different time.
But I went through the motions of the outrage with Billy Bush and Trump when I heard that. I remember my friend Fancy Fred showed me the tape of Trump, and I went, that's not going to hurt him. The thing about grabbing a woman's and that the first time I saw it, I said, so not so what? But I go, well, what? This is nothing
compared to what he said.
Yeah,
already.
Like,
yeah.
Why would this? And I kind of said, well, we're choosing to be outraged by this now because it's so close to the election. We had to find something to nail him on. But it wasn't until Michelle Obama spoke that I really grasped how horrible it was, how truly horrific it is what he said. I mean, like, I knew in theory that it was wrong what he said and people shouldn't talk that way. But it wasn't until Michelle gave that speech where I went, oh, this is a seminal moment in American history. This is where now women, this is an issue that...
It happened to happen at a time when America
was ready.
Blowing up over the idea that we're finally learning how much sexual assault is happening.
Right.
Which I think men like us were blissfully unaware of.
Right.
I think that's the thing.
And didn't care. That's the thing about Billy Bush. Billy Bush is the real criminal in all this.
Because it would have been almost nothing for him to say, okay, Donald, come on.
Right.
But he encouraged it.
Yeah. I mean, Donald Trump's a sociopath. Billy Bush is a nice young man from a good family who should have said something. Because you can't expect a sociopath just needs to be arrested. But to encourage it and laugh. And then his lawyer, Billy Bush's lawyer, who's negotiating a $10 million exit from NBC, says, well, if Billy Bush had said, go F yourself, he would have been fired. Yeah. You didn't have to say. I mean, he immediately went to go F yourself to, hey, you're out of line.
All he had to do was not laugh. Mm-hmm. And he would have kept his job. If he was silent, you could have implied, oh, he must be really uncomfortable.
Right.
And we would have not given him a moment of grief over it.
You know, for the past 2 years, I've been saying on this show, since the midterms of 2014, I said something's happening in this country with women vis-a-vis men. There's something is bubbling to the surface. There's the world is changing. For men, that women have always thought this way and have always known something, but something happened after the 2014 midterms where women woke up and realized guys just don't get it. When you had the guy saying, I think it was the 2014, where you had
Yeah, that's around when this all started happening.
Well, when you had them talking, the guy saying that rape victims produce a fluid that kills the sperm.
Is that Murdoch? Ways of shutting that down.
Yeah.
Yeah, was that Murdoch or the other guy?
I think that was 2012.
Was that 2012? Okay.
That was the, congressional race out in, I don't know where it was, I think Arizona. It was, yeah.
And then you had Sandra Fluke. When was that?
That was maybe a little bit before that. Was that 2012?
Was that during the, Obamacare?
She definitely spoke at a presidential convention, so it had to be 08 or 12.
No, I think it was either 12 or 14, and 2012 or 2014. Rush Limbaugh was attacking her, calling her a whore. She said,
because she takes birth control every single day is one of his points.
Right. He didn't understand how birth control works.
Yeah.
He said, you know, he thinks you just take it when you...
Yeah.
And I think a lot of women woke up, I think, and said, forget it. Men just don't understand it. They just... My daughter, anyway, we've had a lot of women. Micah Fox looks at me and, you know, on the show and talks about the patriarchy and how it just has to be destroyed. And I think she's joking. And I realize, no, she means this. And
can I tell a very short story?
Sure, I'm rambling.
Because this is years ago. This is when I was maybe just finished college. And my little brother is 2 years younger than me. And I've had many opportunities. Like, I've never felt like such a great person as when I've hung out with his friends and tried to stop them. Because they're so, not my brother, but some of his friends were so cartoonishly horrible that I had to be that guy. And one of the cases was they're sitting around and they're having a serious conversation about getting one of those mail order brides and tricking her into coming to the country only to find out that she was going to be shared by all these different dudes. And right. I said to them in the moment, and they could not tell I was joking. I was like, well, why stop there? You know how much money you can get harvesting organs? Mm-hmm. I mean, you're going to get bored with her soon enough anyway. You know how much money? We can make a profit off this. And they're like, well, that's going too far. And I'm just like, oh my God, you don't realize what the point of what I'm saying here is?
Right.
And that was, you know, early 2000s, you know, before that became a popular thing. And these are the same groups, not the same group, but, you know, my brother's other friends. I was at their frat on 9/11. And I had to this day, what I consider the esteemed honor of getting to be the one to say the words, no, we're not going to go out and find a towel head
mm-hmm.
at this frat on 9/11, like, you know, that were whipping themselves up into a frenzy. And, but that attitude that, where the guy didn't get I was joking and was like, no. I'm just talking about us, you know, tricking her into this country and then having to be a sex slave. I'm not talking about doing anything wrong. Like you crazy person wanting to harvest her kidneys. And yeah, he thought that was the line of evil.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have to control the way people think. There's a reason we have schools and colleges and religion and laws, and when libertarians start talking about freedom, it's really the laziness of not having to think the right way. I should be able to think any way I want. No, you can't think a certain way. And you can legislate behavior. You can change how people think about homosexuals and black people and Muslims. And the idea that, you know, the mind police. Yeah, we need mind police to some degree.
But I don't think you can make governments change things like that. I mean, maybe to some extent in schools, but I think the most you can hope for is that people learn through peer pressure or actual penalties that there are some things you cannot do or say without severe ostracism, or if you're doing something that you can't do, then you're in trouble and you will go to jail or whatever. But teaching people how to think as a government project is going to be a tricky area.
It's got to be done subtly, and I'm kind of painting with a broad brush stroke to make a point, but you teach when the Supreme Court rules that gay marriage is okay, even though most Americans, I think a majority of Americans, are still against gay marriage.
I think so. I thought that we had, I was even going to say, what is it that made so many Americans change their minds on gay marriage in the last 10 years?
What happened was it got legalized in more and more states. So people started going, oh, okay. You know, have you seen this new map, electoral map, If Only Men Voted?
Yeah.
I heard about it. I don't think I've seen it.
Tell.
Well, they put out, 538 put out two different maps, one if only women could vote, one if only men could vote. And it's exactly what you might imagine. If only women could vote, landslide Hillary. If only men could vote, landslide Trump. And Eric Trump actually posted the men one because he thought it was a regular. He just thought the new polls were out.
Mm-hmm.
And he posted, look how great we're doing. But
didn't that that surprised me? I didn't think most men.
Yeah, that surprises me also.
Oh, I thought that white men, but this was all men.
Well, because most men are white in this country.
51% makes it turn a certain color.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, yeah. Well, about almost two thirds of this country is white, and half of those are men. And white men, and as white men, this is depressing to know that. Because to me, white
men. But all men. This is all men. Trump would win among all men.
But he loses among black men. It's just he wins among white men by so much that it makes up for all the minorities that he's losing with. And to me, and I don't mean this like in a, it sounds wrong the way I'm saying it, but I mean it literally. White men are the most objective people in this election because they're the only ones that Trump hasn't offended. And when I say I don't mean that they're more objective, I mean they're the only ones who don't have a very specific on paper reason for why they should be opposing Trump. And they're going for Trump, which is depressing.
Well, certain slivers of white men get peeled off by him, whether it's Jews or I'm sure like academics or economists or any sort of professional chunk that you want to look at. It must be whittled down pretty severely.
Well, you're saying that he's getting rid of Jews? Or
I'm saying that, all right, white Jewish men are white men, but I don't think a majority of them are on board with Trump now.
Although he's done a pretty good job of co-opting them by playing the Israel card.
Oh, yeah. Jews always disappoint me with how one issue they can be. And I live in an Orthodox Jewish neighborhood. And my grandmother tells
me... 80% of American Jews tend to vote
Democrat.
Properly.
But not the Orthodox ones. Those are often...
Which is pretty good. It says a lot about Jews that only 20% of a religion are horrible, disgusting human beings. I mean, that's a pretty good... That makes me proud to be Jewish, that only one out of five of us should be...
But, I mean, look, I see a lot of Trump stickers in with the Hasidic neighborhoods. And I think because they are people who just
You see them, but you didn't believe them.
They have a ton of fear. They're very...
Sorry.
They're
on cold medicine.
Yeah, you should be sorry.
But, I mean, the things that I hear them saying for the last 8 years, my grandmother would go over, and she's the only non-Orthodox person on this block, but she would hear things about Obama that only exist on, you know, early morning radio.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they would have no problem believing the absolute worst about Obama. And these are the same people, for some reason, who thought Hillary was fine in 08, and now she's the worst human being alive.
Right. Steve Young.
Oh, hi.
What'd you major in college?
English. No particular reason. I just had to do something, and I guess that's what I thought I was doing.
Is it fair to say that you believe that politics is just a bunch of noise?
No. God bless you if you care to hear that. A bunch of noise. No, I find it so distressing that I have a low tolerance for immersing myself in it. And I think a bunch of noise seems to indicate that it's trivial, and I don't find it trivial at all. And I find... People have asked me in the past year, oh, you must be so sad Dave's off the air. Don't you wish you were on the air writing Trump jokes mm-hmm. for Dave Letterman? I said, no. I think all the political humor that I see is preaching to the choir, and you're only reaching the people
right.
who already agree with you. And as brilliant as a piece of satire might be, it's not going to change one vote.
No, it isn't.
And I find that very depressing. And I don't like comedy that just... tries to reach people who already agree with you somehow. I don't know. So
isn't there something to be said about a great argument getting through to people in that comedy? Sort of when you laugh at something, you're almost acknowledging that you believe in it.
Yeah, I mean, I may be exaggerating when I say that political humor in the past year has changed no one's mind.
I agree.
I bet that there are... outliers on the bell curve in either direction.
I think the Colbert Report, he doesn't do it anymore, mm-hmm. really. I think that might have changed a couple of minds because so many conservatives thought he was real. So that when they find out that it's a put-on, then it becomes Swiftian, mm-hmm. A Modest Proposal.
Yeah, I was thinking of Swift. I mean, that is a piece of writing that's endured, but at the time, did it change anyone's philosophy? Or
no, behavior? The famine, I always say, what happened after A Modest, he talks about eating Irish babies, which is insane, because there was very little meat on their bones. Welsh babies were more delicious at the time. But if you look at A Modest Proposal, and people say, you know, political satire is so important, what did it accomplish? I mean, when was the Irish famine? 1840?
Well, the potato famine, are we talking about? Yeah, that was the 1840s.
And when was the Modest Restoration literature?
I thought
1700s?
I thought Swift was before that.
Like the late 1600s, early 1700s?
Here, let me pull up a gadget.
Nah, that's cheating.
Okay.
So what did he accomplish?
Yeah, I don't know. That's never mentioned in the Norton Anthology of English Literature that I recall.
You know, all the praise that Stewart and Bill Maher got, well, George Bush got reelected. So, yeah. Allan Sherman.
Yes.
We're going to play a clip. Here's something that's amazing. Dave, how is this possible that Dave Sirus, Dave Sirus?
Hello. A little bit. Hey.
Brilliant comedy writer. Steve Young. Brilliant comedy writer. Very funny. Very smart. Reads a lot. He's a Jew.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. This is a Jew.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Hi.
How is it possible that he doesn't know who Allan Sherman is? Do not answer this question. I want to discuss this in front of you. How old are you?
38.
38 years old. You are Steve Young. Look at this man. Brilliant. Well-read. When you sit around with him, he can talk for 45 minutes straight. I hang on every word. How is it possible that he does not know who Allan Sherman is? Explain that to
me,
Steve Young.
A couple of thoughts. First of all, generational. I'm 51. I barely know who Allan Sherman is, and I'm only talking about him here today because of a couple of songs
he
I
was
brought
Allan,
in.
Allan Sherman was the coach of the New York Giants.
Is that right? Well,
the football team.
He wore many hats, didn't he?
Allie Sherman.
I think we're drifting away from our point.
And you used to be the quarterback for the 49ers, Steve Young.
That's right. Okay, I see how you tie it together.
I'm just the worst human being.
Well, definitely in the top.
By the way, I've been doing this podcast and radio show for 7 years, and there's a cycle that goes. Our numbers are way up. Mm-hmm. And I'd say every 6 months we get this surge where the numbers shoot like, oh my God. And then they go right back down. And that little run that I just did explains why they go right back down.
That's right.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
So Allan Sherman really was only quite popular from about, I don't know, 62 to 65. After that, he was somebody that you heard of, or if you were a certain age, you remembered. But there's no reason for someone in their 30s really to know who Allan Sherman is. You probably faintly know, like, Hello, Mother.
Oh, that
Hello,
guy.
Father. See?
Oh, I know that song.
Yeah. So you know, you have this sort of imprinted faint memory / knowledge, but you don't really know who Allan Sherman is, and there's no real reason you should. He was a TV producer in the 50s into the 60s who had this knack for humorous song parodies, and a friend of his out in Hollywood somehow convinced Warner Brothers Records or something, oh, yeah, you should have him do an album. And they said, fine, as long as it's all public domain material. So they put out this album. What was it? I think it was My Son, the Folk Singer.
Right.
And it took off like a rocket. He couldn't really sing. He could carry a tune, but he had this terrible, strangled voice, which was somehow perfect for comedic songs. And very clever, twisty, lyrical, rhyming lyrics, and had quite a run for a few years. He was on game shows. He was on talk shows. He put out like four or five albums, and then he inevitably, well, maybe not inevitably, but he did have a long, slow, sad decline, which I've read some about. He died in 1973. He was only like 50 or something. And I read a grim phrase about him once. Toward the end, he was too fat to drive.
Yeah. Sounds like Artie Lang, who was too fat to fish.
That's right. Right? No, there is precedent, yes.
So the greatest joke I wrote this year, this is the best joke I wrote, and nobody... What's the joke? Tell them.
I forgot. You have to tell
the Bernie Sanders joke.
Yeah, but you tell it.
You know, Bernie Sanders is Jewish, and I'm worried if he gets elected president, does he have a dual loyalty as a Jew? You know, what if America, God forbid, ever went to war with an Allan Sherman record? Now... That's the best joke I wrote all year, but you have to know right. What dual loyalty means and would we go to the
People
Israel
under
thing.
45 aren't going to get the reference.
But there were like three people. Your uncle loved that joke, right?
Yeah.
Maybe it's not that funny. Maybe it's just because nobody's going to get it, they laugh really hard. How much of that has to do with comedy? How much of laughter comes from, I'm the only one who really gets this, so I have to laugh really hard?
Hmm.
Isn't that, you know, a lot of Letterman was...
Sometimes he threw in a monologue joke that depended on knowing some reference from 1961, mm-hmm. and the audience would sort of chuckle in confused puzzlement, and then Dave would bashfully say, well, that one was really just for me.
Right.
Well, there are some people who want to be the only person laughing at a joke to show that they're smarter than everyone else.
Right.
And
right.
There's most people who are terrified of being the only person to laugh at a joke. I mean, we know that audiences... There's a certain percentage of people who are willing to laugh first. And if they don't laugh first, even people who thought that was a brilliant joke are going to stay quiet.
Wow.
Right.
And that infuriates you as a stand-up because you know this is a good joke and you know these people are just too timid to let themselves go without that one percentage of person who's just – who like me, I love it when I'm the only one laughing because I feel like I'm better than the rest of you now.
I'm going to confess to a horrible, horrible transgression that I committed. Christopher Plummer played Iago in Othello on Broadway. And it was my freshman year in college, and the professor said that Iago, the evil Iago who arranges for Desdemona to get Scalia'd by Othello. Pillow.
Suffocate.
I always say, isn't it ironic Scalia'd. That the most homophobic Supreme Court justice died biting a pillow? So I knew, because my professor had said so, that Iago was funny. And, you know, at the time, he was a comic figure. So I laughed really hard. I went in going, well, I'm going to laugh at Iago. I was 18, drinking, smoking dope. And I made a complete asshole out of it. This is just detestable. What a horrible human being I am.
So you didn't really think it was funny?
No, I wanted to show off, like, I know that this is really funny.
Or I'm enjoying this on a different level.
Yes.
You guys can't access.
Yes. And really, I'm just an asshole.
Oh.
And thank God I moved to San Francisco and got the shit kicked out of me. I don't believe in bullying. We'll get to it, Alex, in a second. But I do believe, I don't believe in bullying. But I do believe that somebody at the age of 18 who goes to see Othello and laughs at Iago to show how smart he is, I think he deserves to just get his ass kicked.
Everyone needs some humiliation.
Yeah.
Because we need humility.
Yeah.
So absolutely. I think you can call it bullying, but people call the term bullying changes so much.
Yeah.
There are people who think it's bullying just to not want to be friends with someone.
Right.
But yeah, I would definitely say that, like, I feel like I'm a better person because of some of the most embarrassing things that have ever happened to me.
Yeah, sometimes you need to be set straight.
Yeah.
Not if you're gay, though. Okay, what do we have?
Oh,
well. Oh, well, let's talk about Allan Sherman.
Allan Sherman.
And I'm sorry, I'm rambling, and I'm having a good time, by the way.
I can tell.
Even though
you're detestable.
I'm grotesque. Everything is coming up profits, the golden age of industrial musicals. The sizzle reel's phenomenal.
For the documentary.
For the documentary.
Yeah.
You've been on the show before, but I love hearing this story. Tell us how you discovered these industrial musicals, what they were, who they employed. Mm.
So I grew up knowing nothing about Broadway musicals or anything
we
like that.
We get it. You're married. You have kids. You're not gay. We get it. Okay. Jesus, this homophobia is just getting worse with this guy.
Well, thanks for setting me straight.
Don't make me laugh.
At the Letterman Show, they used to do a bit called Dave's Record Collection, which was a found comedy piece, actual unintentionally funny record albums that Dave would hold up. We'd hear a clip. He'd have a joke. It fell to me at one point to be the captain of this piece and to go out and find record albums that we could use on the show. So back in the early to mid-90s, there were still places you could go around Manhattan. Thrift shops, of course, had lots of records, used record stores. And I was coming back from my hunting trips with all sorts of different instructional records and bizarre records of all sorts, but I started finding these.
Now, I'm curious. Yeah. Was that a chore for you, an assignment? Did you like doing it? Did you say to yourself, well, this isn't writing. This is...
Yeah, well, it was fun to go out and have a little afternoon out of the office, but I had joined the show when the early years of record collection had kind of scooped up all the low-hanging fruit, all the William Shatner records and Leonard Nimoy and other celebrities who shouldn't have been singing. So we'd kind of reached the end of that easy first phase of it, and it was harder and harder to get good stuff together. And I think just because I took an interest in it and tried really hard, I kept the piece going longer than it might have.
What, before we get to the industrial musicals, was there an album that was so funny, but you couldn't put it on TV?
Hmm.
Was there one that, like, just cracked you guys up, but you realized, you know what, this would just be...
No, I think anything that we found that was really awful and even problematic, we put some weird things on the air. I mean, some of them were very harmless, like... learn to take dictation and listen to these letters. And there were funny things about, I am making out my will and I am cutting my daughter out of the will. And you'd have to, oh, better write that down. But there were a few lesbian-themed albums that some particular little niche label put out. And there was some song called Any Woman Can Be a Lesbian.
That we really?
Kept, yeah, that we, like, I think this was even before I joined the show, but they kept playing that song for days and weeks afterwards, I think. But I started finding these corporate event souvenir records, and I thought they would have to be speeches, but no, they were full-fledged musicals about selling insurance or tires or tractors or Coca-Cola or whatever, and some of them were miserable and wrong-headed, and some of them were shockingly high quality and compelling, and that's kind of where I fell down this trap door that opened up and into this alternate universe of show business, because it was vast and it was incredibly well-funded and it was pervasive for many decades, and it was almost entirely off the radar screen of everybody in America, except if you went to one of these conventions, you would see it. But you didn't know what was happening at the 1,000 other conventions that were happening the same year. Nobody had ever really tried to collect it or understand it before. So among the records in my collection is an Allan Sherman record. This was from 1966 when he had just started to slide down off his peak and got this corporate gig. This was never a live stage show. Most of what I collect is actual live stage musicals, but this one is so charming that I had to include it in the book.
Well, this has to be because he did song parodies.
Yes.
So is this copywritten material?
Well, I don't entirely know about the origin of the music on this. It does not parody songs that I know, but I think at least one of them must be a parody, and maybe some of your listeners will understand what it is and will fill me in. But he was hired by the Scott Paper Company's Container Division to do an album of specialty songs about Scott paper cups and vending machines, which would be then distributed only to vending industry VIPs.
And didn't you and I write a sketch like this?
I think you had something about a vending machine that
hall. A big musical number we wrote?
I can't remember. But so this one-sided album of songs, some of which are definitely parodies, about paper cups and vending machines given out only to vending industry VIPs. And I don't know how many vending industry VIPs there were, but enough so that the album does turn up. It's pretty scarce, but the songs are just ridiculous and charming and very well done. And even most Allan Sherman fans don't really know this stuff.
Okay, before we play it, I just want to mention that Showbiz Studios now has playback ability.
Oh.
So we can listen to it in real time. And I've always wanted to hold a pen and say to the engineer, and just flick the pen at him to play it.
Well, we've got two songs here. One is called There Are Cups, and one is called Scott Cups, and either one will be fine.
Okay, and to inaugurate our new playback feature here in Showbiz Studios, the people at home have to imagine me holding a pen, and I'm going to like shake it at the engineer, and then it's going to magically play like you see in real professional studios.
He really is holding a pen.
Yes. And it's not working.
Things taste better in Scott cups. Water's wetter in Scott cups.
Gin.
Beer is sudsier. Soup is slurpier. Alka-Seltzer is three times burpier. When you've got cold or hot cups manufactured by the people at Scott. Ice is colder in Scott cups. Scotch tastes older in Scott cups. Any cola tastes so much colder. Holy water is somewhat holier. You can't lose when you use the cups manufactured by the people at Scott. You pour some Metrical into a cup by Scott. Before you're finished drinking, you have lost your pot. A little bit of prune juice works a whole lot faster. Not to mention oil of castor. Frank and Dino use Scott cups. Drink their vino from Scott cups. Moonshine served in Scott cups in Georgia. And history tells us Lucretia Borgia served her drinks to those finks in cups manufactured by the people at Scott. Tennis champion told them they could save his cup. He'd rather have a Scott cup than the Davis cup. And glue that's in a Scott cup is a lot more gluish. Chicken soup tastes twice as Jewish. Bees make honey in Scott cups. Scott makes money from Scott cups. So keep ordering, and eventually Scott will come out okay financially. Yes, by gum, order some cups from Scott and not from Lily. Not from Dixie, don't be silly. Not from Sweetheart or Monsanto or Conex or the Continental Canco. Join the cause and buy a lot of cups manufactured by the people at... What the heck was that name?
He was... That, right? I mean...
That really is good.
It's genius.
But he didn't write the music for that.
I don't think so.
The music is
so
good. Music, I mean...
But the lyrics, I mean, it's like...
It's good, yeah.
It's beyond... I don't want to sound pompous and start dissecting the frog, but...
Mm-hmm.
You know, this was a cash run for Allan Sherman, and it couldn't have been any more perfect.
The glee is palpable, I think, as he, for whatever reason, he's offered this and he decided to do it. And then I think a lot of times in these corporate gigs, people said, yeah, I'll do it. And then they get drawn into it and think, wow, well, you know, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to really try to have fun with it. And, oh. Suddenly it's 18 hours later,
and
I'm sweating over making this even better and even better and perfect. And, Yeah, I think he had a great deal of talent that he had focused in a narrow wedge of showbiz. But
I mean, it's almost, I hate to, it's almost like a primer in how to do. Is that one of the best examples?
It definitely is very accessible to a lot of people.
Who else did you? The guys who wrote Fiddler on the Roof did this?
Yeah, Sheldon Harnick and Jerry Bock.
And Sheldon Harnick's in your documentary.
Yes, he's 92 now, and I interviewed him last summer, and he said when he got to New York in the 50s, and he was trying to become a songwriter and make ends meet, these corporate shows were a great lifeline for him, and he actually found himself enjoying the craftsmanship and puzzle and challenge
right.
of it so much that when he started to get real work, he was sad about leaving industrials behind to some extent.
Well, it's about something.
It's
not fluff. It's about something very specific.
It is about something extremely specific, which is both a curse and a blessing, I guess.
Well, it's not about love. And
right.
But so what else? Now you have another song for us, right?
Oh, yeah. We got one other one from the Scott Paper Cups album.
There's more than one album?
No, there's one other song from the album.
Is this Allan Sherman?
There are cups with leaky bottoms. There are cups with tacky tops. There are cups with different daffy defects. So your drink drains out in drippy drops. There are cups that look so misbegotten, 'cause the way they're made is not so hot. All those cups, inadequate and rotten, they ain't cups that were made by Scott. There are cups that bend when vending. There are cups that tip and tilt. There are cups so clumsy when descending that their contents frequently get spilt. There are cups whose seams are slightly fractured, so they break or bulge or bend or warp. We deny those cups were manufactured by the good old Scott Paper Corp. There are cups with sexy bottoms. There are cups with shapely tops. Cups so swell, you'd think they ought to sell them in the finest kind of china shops. Gorgeous cups, so slim and sleek and upright. Cuddly cups, designed exclusively by the folks who always make a cup right. That's the Scott Paper Company.
Wow. So is this an entire album of Allan Sherman singing?
Yes, it's a one-sided album.
How many songs?
Six or seven.
There's six or seven.
Yeah.
You know, when you come back, I want to say something about that song, and I want to ask you guys a question. So this is how you become a producer. I couldn't write that. I couldn't sing it. I couldn't play the music. I cannot do anything that Allan Sherman does in that song that you just played me. But I can criticize it.
Okay.
I'm being serious.
Yeah.
So I'm listening to it because, you know, and this is how you become a producer. When you have no talent, you can judge the food. I felt it was overpowered by the music, that the band was just so incredible. And I would assume Allan Sherman wanted it that way because I don't think the lyrics were that funny. So, but was he using the band to overpower him? Was that extra seasoning because the meat might not have been fresh?
I don't think so. I think the Scott Paper people just thought, oh, yeah, we should have some funny songs and Allan Sherman should do them. And I'm sure that the lyrics were supposed to be the main attraction here.
But that was all about the musicianship, wasn't
it?
Yeah,
that was, I got some very good studio people of some sort, and I do suspect that that melody is lifted from some other song. I've heard something very similar to it on, I think it was an Ortho Pharmaceuticals show.
Yeah. Well, you'll come back?
Oh, sure.
I want to play you something we found. We were looking to hire a voiceover artist, and I found some work that Mark Thompson, who's a friend of the show, did for us 6 years ago. Ned Rice and I, the great comedy writer Ned Rice, and I wrote this for Mark. Mark is doing all the voices, and the idea is that voiceover artists who do attack ads are now beginning to attack each other.
Chet Perkins is a voiceover artist who lives in New York City. You heard his voice on commercials for John McCain, Barack Obama, and the Olive Garden. Sounds like Chad Perkins will say nice things about anybody if the money's right. I guess that's just how they do things in New York City. I'm Bill Jenkins, and I approve this message. Paid for by the Bill Jenkins Committee for Responsible Voice Work.
Chad Perkins responded with this.
Voiceover artist Bill Jenkins has a problem. Bill Jenkins said in a series of commercials blanketed throughout all of California that teachers' unions are too powerful. At the same time, Bill Jenkins' voice was all over the airwaves in Texas, saying teachers' unions were just fine. Which one is it, Bill? Flip, flop. I'm Chad Perkins, and I approve this ad. Paid for by Citizens United for voiceover reform. Chad Perkins, chairman.
So, of course, Bill Jenkins was outraged, and he responded with this attack on Chad Perkins.
It's easier to face the day feeling fresh. Summer's Eve. Look and feel your best.
There he goes again, reading an endorsement for a product he doesn't even use. Turns out voiceover artist Chad Perkins will read just about anything they put in front of him. Claims it's his job.
Cyberbullying isn't cool, and it hurts. For more information, go to stopcyberbullying.org.
What are you selling today, Chad? Do we need voiceover artists who are in the pocket of big advertising? Is that good for America? Bill Jenkins doesn't think so. I'm Bill Jenkins, and I approve of this ad. Paid for by the committee that thinks Chad Perkins is a douchebag.
Okay, now it started to get really, really ugly. Here, take a listen to Chad Perkins' response. This one, I think, really crossed the line.
Bill Jenkins was all over the airwaves last night, telling the good people of Kansas that marriage is a union between a man and a woman. How would he know? Isn't Bill Jenkins still living on that farm with his mother? Kind of strange for a man in his 50s. I'm Chad Perkins, and I approve this ad. Paid for by the Committee to Preserve Traditional Voiceover Work.
So, Bill Jenkins, with his manhood and morality now on the line, fired back with this.
Chad Perkins and his wife Jenny have 3 boys, Dylan, Kyle, and Henry. But hold on a second. Chad and Jenny have had sex hundreds, if not thousands of times. What happened to all those other babies Jenny conceived? They all just disappeared? Chad, the next time you're recording a radio spot for Focus on the Family, why don't you ask Dr. James Dobson what happened to all those innocent, unborn babies? I'm Bill Jenkins, and I'm not gay. Paid for by Charlie Crist for Senate, 2010.
A little long. I wanted you to... I know we're out of time. Thank you for laughing. That we wrote that 6 years ago. We did that with Mark Thompson. And does that hold up? Is it too long?
Yeah.
I mean, if you were to critique that...
I liked it going back and forth.
If you were to critique that, what would you... It was too long.
I don't know. I suppose you could, we learned at Letterman you can always cut something.
Mm-hmm.
And we were always trying to make things shorter. But I don't know. I like something that's allowed to breathe.
Boy, go ahead.
No, I mean, I think that, you know, things like that can go on much longer if you want. They can go shorter. I have no problem with, you know, really building a bit. And it actually, when you said about holding up, it reminded me so much when the Hava Nagila kicks in, it made me think of and never acknowledging the Judaism of just happening to have Jewish music while talking about someone who'll do anything for money. And obviously that's the joke. But it reminds me so much of when Trump puts out an image of Hillary and a Jewish star and surrounded by money, and then says, "Why not? I didn't say anything about her being Jewish. I just said she loves money." And that felt especially fresh to me.
We did sketches on the radio show from 2010 to about 2013, and I did all the engineering and the sound effects and all that stuff. I just couldn't afford it anymore. We had to stop. But that's Mark Thompson. Because that took me, I would say, 4 hours to just edit and get it down. Mm-hmm. But it was written by Ned Rice. I think I wrote that with him. I'm not sure. But Ned Rice, brilliant, brilliant comedy writer. And Mark Thompson. There's some stuff I want to play of Robert Smigel doing Trump, which we've played. Not today. We're going to wrap it up. The hardest Robert and I ever laughed was during the debates. This is 4 or 5 years ago. He used to do me interviewing Donald Trump, and the whole purpose of the interview was for him to call Rosie O'Donnell a pig.
Mm-hmm.
So no matter what he did, the punchline was always something getting back to the fact that Rosie O'Donnell's a fat pig. And then 3 years later pass, and suddenly, or 2 years later pass, and suddenly there's the first debate. And Trump, like right out of the gate, he calls Rosie O'Donnell a pig. And like we started, I mean, we're laughing.
Now you're talking about the general, not even the primary, where he also brought her up.
Right.
You know, I was talking about the Megyn Kelly thing, where that was right out the gate.
The first debate.
He brings her name up.
And it was like, wait a second. We were joking that he's going to run for office for the sole purpose of making fun of Rosie O'Donnell. And the first, it was just bizarre. We must have. I don't know how there's so many sketches written. Robin Williams, Martin Short, Nathan Lane, Andrea Martin, Paul Dooley, written Patton Oswalt, Paul F. Tompkins. Who's Melissa Villaseñor, who's now on SNL? I have to go through all this stuff and find it and start playing it. It's a little dated. The Charlie Crist in 2010 is a little dated. But I was kind of pleasantly surprised that held up.
No, that was funny. Yeah.
Maybe, wow,
I mean, certain election things are just universal.
Yeah, it's interesting.
You know, it's because we go through the same process every year, except for this one, where, you know, a monkey wrench was thrown into it. But it's still, you know, familiar. It's still, we know how it works. And that's what's been so great about this election, is watching the thing you never thought would break have to deal with the ultimate bull in a china shop, which is a big reason why people are willing to forgive what Trump is like. They just want to see people uncomfortable.
The hardest thing Alex Brazil ever had to deal with, and then we're going to wrap it up. About 6 months ago, it came out that Donald Trump had been calling people up, pretending to be somebody else, as his own publicist.
John Miller.
Yeah, John Miller. So Robert, I said to Robert, why don't you call into my, we'll pretend we're taking calls, and you call in as Trump, pretending to be black, pretending to be a woman, pretending to be a Mexican, talking about how much you love Donald Trump. Well, Robert did it. You know, did it from his house. So he did Donald Trump imitating a black person, saying, Donald, I like Donald, and he imitated Trump trying to pretend to be Mexican.
Wow.
And I would try to trap him into saying huge. He'd be going, he didn't want to say huge. Anyway, it's a half hour of it, and it's absolute genius. Robert, it's like one of the funniest things. And I played it for Robert. He didn't like it. And I just said, all right, forget it. I'll play it for you. It's one of the funniest things I'm going to ask him to listen to it again mm-hmm. to try to get permission to play. He didn't think it was funny.
Wow.
It was one of the funniest things I've ever heard. Anyway. All right. So let me plug some stuff here. Steve Young, how do people contact you, Steve Young?
Oh, boy. Well, I've got my website, steveyoungworld.com. I think there's something on there you can click if you're of a mind to.
Okay. And what is Celebrigum?
Oh, that's another old project from a few years ago. I know you're trying to wrap it up, so I won't make it.
Right, we'll talk about that. And the industrial musical movie you'll hopefully be on all the time, bringing any clips like this, more Allan Sherman. You take this show on the road, right?
I have a pretty good pile of vintage film from these sorts of things now, from the 60s and 70s, and I have about a 90-minute show that I do where I explain to people what the genre is and how I found the record albums and worked on the book with my friend Sport, and then now the new wave is films coming in from either film collectors or people who did this sort of work and have things lingering in their attics and basements. So that is wonderfully surreal.
You did it, and you've reunited people, and you do a tour, and you'll come back and plug your tour dates. You did the Northwest, right?
Well, I did, in July I was in the Pacific Northwest, and then I did some in Texas and Arizona. I was in Pennsylvania last week.
Wow.
And I don't have anything else scheduled at the moment, but I think it'll keep going.
Good. Well, you'll come back, I hope. Mm-hmm. And thank you for doing this. It was serendipitous. I haven't been feeling well, and this really cheered me up. Dave Sirus, how do people reach you?
Twitter, I guess.
What's your handle?
Dave Sirus, S-I-R-U-S, is my Twitter. You can just go say hi to me there. That's the only thing I really check.
Great.
And, if you want to see Brickstone videos, go just Google
that
Brickstone.
That we forgot to talk. Sidney Blumenthal's son did something similar 4 years ago.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I'll talk to you about it next time. Hey, do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. We get a small percentage. It doesn't cost more. You're taking money out of Amazon's pocket. You can listen to the show now on YouTube. It'll be interesting to see if we get a copyright mark because of the Allan Sherman song.
That will be interesting.
Yeah, it'll be very, because they have a program that determines whether or not the music is copyrightable. Mm-hmm.
Well, since those tracks I don't think were ever commercially released, I'm optimistic.
But whenever there's music, they kind of get upset. We're going to wrap it up. We're on YouTube and David Feldman Show on iTunes and Stitcher. Pass it along to your friends from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us.